Now, in our interview, Dr. Ibrahim Kana talks about the Save 1 Million Lives project. Dr. Ibrahim Kana, thank you for joining us on the program.
Thank you very much.
Let's begin a conversation by talking about the Saving 1 Million Lives project. Now, we do know that it has a laudable objective, which include utilization and quality of high impact reproductive as well as child health and indeed nutrition. It was launched in 2012.
Correct.
Where are we at the moment?
Well, I think we've made significant progress in the sense that the program, as the name implies, Saving 1 Million Lives, program for result, two components matched together. One, statistics shows that close to 1 million mothers and children are lost every year. And that's why we give them Saving 1 Million Lives. Program for result is an innovative method of financing primary healthcare in Nigeria. They are matched together for us to implement throughout the country. So since the outset, I think we've made a lot of progress in the sense that we have made states to focus on the areas of data, to focus more attention on areas of maternal, newborn and child health. Overall, we have made states to focus on attaining universal health coverage. You know, basically, we try to put states in front in such a way that we say, follow this, do this, you achieve result, we give you money. So as against the previous system whereby federal government actually construct health facilities, recruit health workers, now we want the states to compete with itself. Sokoto compete with Sokoto, Lagos compete with Lagos. Then we provide you with disbursement after each round of surveys. We have conducted one round of survey and 12 states have achieved improvement and we give them funds.
Can you put figures to this improvement we're talking about?
Yeah, improvement now, we consider the fact that every state, with or without federal government intervention, each state must have at least 1 percentage point increase in the indices of maternal, newborn and child health. Therefore, we carefully selected the key indicators that are important in improving maternal, newborn and child health and nutrition as well. Now, based on that, we assume that for each year, every state must achieve at least 1 percentage point increase. Therefore, the funds we are given for each additional percentage point increase, we are giving the state $205,000, significant amount of money, really. However, at the beginning of the program, the federal government decided to give as a pump $1.5 million to each state of the federation. Mm. And so that to help the state actually to kickstart the process of providing primary health care to the populace at the state level.
Forgive me if I probe further. 1 percentage point increase in terms of figures, in terms of number of women that has been saved. Can you put a figure to that as well?
Yes. Now, if you look at that varies from state to state. Now, the percentage point increase is improvement in the services provided. Take, for example, number of children that sleep under the nets. The percentage point increase is there must be a certain number of children that must be sleeping under the nets each year, so long as you provide the nets. Women, prevention of elimination of mother to child transmission, women must be screened for HIV during antenatal. The percentage point increment is that there must be a certain number of increment of women that attend antenatal and also screen for HIV so that we can eliminate transmission of mother to child transmission. Ditto for women under reproductive age, accepting or having access to modern contraceptives. Ditto also for children immunized with penta-3. Similarly, children also taking vitamin A. So these are the specific indicators that we're measuring. Therefore, every year, if in a state like Lagos State, that has about 10 million population, and out of that, let's say 10% of the population actually children, meaning 1 million of the children, 1 million of the population of Lagos are children under 5. It now assume that every year, our target is the entire 1 million population must be immunized must have access to vitamin A.
This program, if I remember correctly, the initial target is 2015.
That's correct.
How come we're still running?
Well, that's the beauty about the P4R. The P4R, the funds are there. The federal government took a credit of $500 million from the World Bank, which really is an active partnership between us and the World Bank to fund or to finance this project. Now, the whole idea is, we decided not to make it as a project with a beginning and an end, but a program so that it will help in strengthening our healthcare system. Here, we're talking about the primary healthcare system. So in as much as we said it was going to last 2015, actually, it was relaunched in 2015 to last till 2019. But the beauty about it is that the funds are kept. Funds are not given to states. Until surveys are conducted, those states that have attained improvement, they now access the funding. you know. So even as much as I would say we're going to have the program last up to by 2019 to end, I am almost certain, because last survey that we did, only 12 states attained improvement. Therefore, they access the money. The money will continue to remain there in the central bank until states have improvement. You don't attain improvement, sorry, come back next year, the money will continue to be there. That's the beauty about it.
One of your mandates is to improve the state of health care facilities, especially at the primary level. Now, we do know again that most primary health care centers in the country are in a terrible, terrible state.
That's correct.
How is this?
Well, if we say terrible state now, we're not talking about the structures, but studies have shown all over the world that what attracts patients to facilities is not really the structure. Yes, we're talking about quality of care, which also talks about the ambience of the facility. But beyond that, the services being provided, the quality of services being provided is what we are looking at. Now, what we decided to do as a federal government, as a government now, is over the years, we have invested so much from MDGs to health sector development, and so many projects that government actually introduced, where we build facilities, we equipped facilities. Even during the MSS era, midwife service scheme, we recruited midwives from Abuja and sent to various states of the Federation. But what the program is doing now is, hey, state, we cannot continue to midwife you. You know, as a state, you should put your people in front. You should make healthcare as a priority. Therefore, you should develop a program that will address those areas that actually cause mothers and children to die every year in your state. Therefore, some states like Rivers State, they have beautiful primary care facilities. If you go to some states, very poor healthcare facilities. Now it's left to those states to now, and that's why we're working with them, to now begin to look carefully in each area, how many healthcare facilities do you have? How many are functional? Now we're now looking at functionality of the primary healthcare center, not the facility alone. Okay. Facility is important, but functionality, patient coming in, having access to, he's well received, first of all, by the quality healthcare worker, being attended to very well, receiving medication, if need for investigations are carried out. Women that are coming for labor, they will have the antenatal there, they will deliver in the facilities. Children will have access to immunization in the facilities. That's what we're looking at in terms of making primary healthcare functional.
Well, let's stay with the primary healthcare. I do know that it's the duty of the local government councils. And here we are now talking about the federal government establishing one PHC per ward across the country.
Now, you see, whether we like it or not, under the Saving $1 million program for result, funds are given directly to the states to implement those activities. But the federal government, again, in its magnanimity, I would like to use the word magnanimity, to support the states, still decided to now make one PHC functional per ward in Nigeria. It is a support. Now, that support, if you look at even one PHC per ward making a functional, is a minuscule of the total number of PHCs in Nigeria. What we are trying to say as a federal government is, states, you also pick up this type of project and also make all the PHCs functional in your state. So what federal government is doing really is just an additional support to what the states are supposed to be doing.
Wouldn't synchronizing all this, state, local government, and the federal government, wouldn't that pose a problem or a challenge to the project?
Actually, it's synergy. It's not a problem, actually, it's a synergy. We're all working under the same system.
So where are we on that at the moment, the federal government PHC?
The federal government PHC made a lot of progress. The Honourable Minister actually directed the Chief Executive of Primary Care Agency, who really is in charge of the PHC revitalization, you know. And so far, I think, I can't tell the exact number, but substantial number have been revitalized from the federal government funds. And definitely, I know for sure, under the Saving $1 million, a lot of states also have picked up that and they're expanding. Some states, I know, like Kebbi State and a few other states, decided to also invest in revitalizing PHCs. Therefore, if you go to some of these states, truly, you see a lot of improvement, and some states are doing well. But of course, I must tell you that some states are also lagging behind.
Exactly. It's heartwarming to know that a lot of progress is being recorded. But if I'm to ask you, where do you think we haven't touched yet in regards to PHCs and how to make them very functional?
Human resources. Human resources. There's a huge disproportion and disproportional allocation of human resources. If you go to Lagos, Abuja, Port Harcourt, you find the highest number of human resources. If you go to states like Sokoto, for example, most of the human resources are actually based inside Sokoto City. You go to Tangaza, Godabawa, Ilela, and some other rural areas, you won't see doctors. Certainly, you won't see consultants. And in PHC, you don't even see nurses. You don't see midwives. You see community health extension workers who, in some cases, are poorly trained. Therefore, that is one area I personally believe government at every level, but particularly the state and local government. My dream is each state should, as a country, each state should target attaining universal health coverage. By that, each state must actually recruit and train her healthcare workers and push them to rural areas where they actually come from.
Let's rush through this last question. Aside from the initial World Bank fund, what other options are there for accessing funding for this project?
Yeah, the beauty of it is that at the beginning, a lot of partners actually became interested, and every day we find more partners actually coming in, trying to see how they will support or how they can come in and contribute to the effort of government in Saving 1 Million Lives program for result. We have the Gates Foundation. For example, the Gates Foundation have actually offered to fund our service for the next 5 years. What it means is that we are now going to have a steady source of acquiring data for the country and for the state and local government in a disaggregated manner, both smart survey and health facility survey. That's one. Two, we have other partners that the Department for Foreign and International Development, DFID, MSCH2, they are also working with us in strengthening the PACs through training and retraining of healthcare workers. We have the EU, we have so many other, WHO, they're constantly there with us, UNICEF, they're constantly there with us, and UNFPA. So,
obviously, the 71 Million Lives Project is something that is dear to you, and you seem to be excited about it.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
Let me thank you very much for coming, Dr. Khan, on the program.
You're welcome.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to thank you for your mails and tweets, as always. I'll take a few of them. I have this one from Engineer Obude. He says, law reforms should not be subjected to conform with the government of the day's priorities, but on a society modeling evolution and growth needs. Keep sending in your views and comments using the email address and, of course, the Twitter handle on your screen. Also, be sure to share anything happening within your locality. Also, don't forget you can view the program on youtube.com/channelsweb/videos. Thank you for your time. I'm Ibrahim Adra. We'll see you next week.